Hi everyone, welcome back to our series on return. So excited to have Miss Leslie Gossen with us for this third session of our series on return. For those of you just joining us for the first time, we are unpacking this book by Brandon Vogt, who it's Return, How to Draw Your Child Back to the Church. And it's been, I've been enjoying it so far.
Very much.
So Leslie, just for those that don't know you, you are a parishioner at St. Leo.
Yes.
And how long have you been a parishioner?
Well, we've been maybe about 4 years. We moved back. My husband lives here. His whole family lived here. But we were in Missouri for about 15 years.
Wow.
And so he was finally able to work out of the house, and he said, I want to go home. He never wanted to leave in the first place. That's one of the great things about this area.
Yeah.
Is that the
people
family
actually like to stay.
And the community, they're so strong. It's so strong. One of the things I really enjoy about living here. I'm a Midwest girl myself, so.
We won't hold that against you.
No, try not to anyway.
What part of the Midwest?
Well, I grew up outside of Chicago, Illinois. Went to college in Iowa. And then I visited my mom in Florida for a time in my life, which was really difficult. And that was supposed to be temporary, but that turned about 9 years. And that's where I met my husband. So, you know, God always has these plans for us that we have no idea about.
Yeah.
It always works out for the best. And then somewhere along the line, he said, let's go to Missouri. And I'm going, you've never lived past I-10. Do you really want to go where it's cold and snowy?
Exactly.
And he handled it better than I did when I went back over there.
Oh, my
to,
goodness.
The snow. Beautiful, though. We had a wonderful 15 years where we raised our kids and where my son got his calling to be a priest. So we're, God, again, has put us where
okay,
we need
so
to be.
Okay, so now you just casually mentioned another big piece about you. Mm-hmm. You have a son who is a priest.
Yes, in the Diocese of Kansas City, St. Joseph, Missouri.
Wow. Yeah. And what's his name?
His name is Father Andrew Mattingly.
Okay.
And he's been a priest since 2015.
Awesome. Love it. So, great. And we are talking about return. So it's kind of ironic that you actually have a son. You have a child not far from the church, but instead who is a priest.
Yeah, definitely.
But you yourself.
Oh, so far away from the church.
Away from the church for a while. So. Tell me a little bit more about that. When did you become Catholic? What drew you to that?
My family did not go to church when I was growing up. I had no clue about anything, really. I started singing a lot, and so my voice teacher invited me to her church when I was about 13. So you need to come sing in the choir and get more exposure with your voice, etc. So I did, and it was like the Congregational United Church of Christ. So I did, and I got involved a little bit, as people do when they start, looking around for things. And I had visited a variety of different churches with friends who would invite me, which, by the way, is the right thing to do. You've got to invite people to come with you who don't have a home, who don't have a church. And so I went to a few places. Anyway, I got involved with that and was actually baptized there when I was 14.
Yeah.
And that's where my questions began.
When you were 14.
Yeah. My questions.
Beautiful.
Who is God? Who is Jesus? I didn't really understand anything.
Mm.
My dad grew up in a very strong Baptist household, and he was pushed so hard in the faith that he gave it completely up. And so we never went to church. My mom was Lutheran, sort of. She was, again, wandering between different Protestant faiths, I guess, when she was young, because her mother didn't go to church regularly. She ended up being Lutheran at some point, and we still haven't been able to find a way to reach her to, change into the Catholic faith, but we're still kind of working on that. And this book is helping me a lot in understanding that.
Sure.
Being her grandson, who she absolutely adores, is a Catholic priest.
Yeah.
He hasn't quite reached her yet either. So,
sure.
Sometimes that return home takes a while.
Absolutely. And takes a lot of patience.
Yeah. So what happened with me is I went to, I left home and went to college like everybody does in a different place. And my roommate was Catholic. And at that point, somewhere along the line, she said, why don't you come to church with me? I said, I don't think so. Sorry, no. Those Catholics. Catholics, they're kind of different, you know. So, and that's kind of like the viewpoint of a lot of people that don't understand our faith.
Yeah.
They've never taken the time to really learn, why do we do what we do?
Sure. A lot of misconceptions.
She followed this book pretty well, though. She was slow going. I was very impressed with her. She was actually my sponsor when I became Catholic.
Okay.
About a year and a half later. And so she invited me again, and I said, I don't think that's for me. She said, well, we're having a get-together with some of our friends, you know, at the Newman Center. Mm-hmm. So why don't you just come with that? There's some great people there. So I did.
Mm.
So again, that's that inviting piece.
Yeah.
And I had a great time. I met a lot of really good people, and it made me happy. So then it was a little while later where I actually went to Mass, and I walked in, and it's like, are you kidding me? These people want to be here. It's exciting. The music is beautiful. And they're praying. I'm going, whew.
So this is a new experience for you. You've never really seen a
community
like that.
No, I had not seen that at all in any place that I had been. So I was hooked right then. I went on a retreat. Again, another piece that they say is a really great way of stepping stone.
Right, right.
Where I found Jesus as a real warm and loving and just special place for me in his life, or I'm in his life, and he loves me. And so I realized that, and I was 22 years old, and I said, wow, this is the coolest thing ever. So that's when that happened. And I went through RCIA and learned a little bit more, although I really didn't learn what I wanted to learn. And so it wasn't until I married my husband, who is a really wonderful, strong Catholic person, where I was encouraged always to follow. We never went on vacation without checking Mass schedules first. Mm. He was that type of person. We didn't do a huge amount of praying at home. We did the rosary during Lent together as a family, but otherwise we just did our weekly thing. Somewhere along the line, seeds were planted in our children, and I'm just so happy to be where I am right now with my faith, although I need to learn so much more about it.
Yeah, sure.
You know, it's a never-ending journey, and that's what's also really super special about the Catholic faith is there's always something more to learn. And the more you learn, the more you know you're in the right place.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Well, I love it. That's a beautiful story. So in some sense, you kind of returned to the Catholic Church. And what I heard you say a number of times is one of the most important pieces was the invitation.
Absolutely.
Just the power of the invite. I think we so often underestimate how powerful that can be.
Very much.
That's exciting. And that definitely brings us back to these chapters. So today we're talking about chapters 8 through 11.
Right.
So
I have lots of copious notes.
Oh, that's great. Love it.
I got the book on my Kindle, and then the real book finally came in just a short time ago. So, you know, I have lots of copious notes.
So you're, that's good. So those that are watching, it's also available on Kindle if you're a Kindle
very
reader.
Much. Yep.
I don't know if it's available yet on Audible, though. I like to listen to audiobooks.
Especially driving in the car long distances.
It's so nice, you know, but I don't know yet if it's available there. But so our previous videos, our first video was on understanding the problem, why it is that so many people are leaving the Catholic Church, and all the different elements involved there. And then the second video was kind of the first half of the game plan. And the first half of the game plan was kind of preparing our own self for the conversation. It was a lot of stuff that we do before we even approach our loved one who's away. But now, chapters 8 through 10, we're jumping into the actual conversations. So, you know, if you're joining us for the first time, it's really, really essential that you follow the first half of the game plan first, chapters 4 through 7, before you jump into our discussion today.
And the book has so many different options for you to learn about the faith, mm-hmm. and they're listed there. There's just lists all kinds of different things that you can read, videos to watch. So I'm excited that they're listed in the book, so I can go back and say, okay, it's like our I'm having trouble here. Let me go ahead and pick this one up so I can learn a little
bit more. I love that too. But yeah, it's so essential that we don't just start the conversation too soon. And that was the whole point of all the chapters before chapter 8 through 11. But once you do all the foundational work and we do all those pieces right, now we're ready to jump into the conversation. So, Leslie, you don't have a child that's away from the church, but you do have loved ones.
Right,
you mentioned
right.
Your mom. You mentioned before we started filming, I think you have some cousins.
Some nephews.
Some nephews. Mm-hmm. Okay.
My mom's an interesting story, though. She worked in a Catholic school as the secretary,
oh, wow.
the bookkeeper, for many years. Mm-hmm. So she has a basic background. She said, oh, I love those priests. Oh, and the sisters, they just come in. They talk all the time mm-hmm. with me. And she really enjoyed that. And then my brother did not want to go, my younger brother, did not want to go to the public high school. It was too big. He was feeling a little bit left out and just a nobody. So then he went to the Catholic high school. And then he, you know, in religion class, he's the one that's asking all the questions to the teacher, trying to stump the teacher on purpose, right? He's that kind of person.
Those are fun.
So he learned a lot about it and yet never really felt called to join.
Yeah.
He is currently Episcopalian, but he left that after a lot of things happened in their church. So he's another one that I kind of pray for and hope that he finds a good path. But my family, we don't live near one another, so it's not something where I can just, go over to their house and have a cup of coffee and, start a conversation. So that's another issue when you have people you want to bring back to the faith, but they're not close to you.
Yeah, sure. So. And you just highlight the fact that there are just so many varying circumstances mm-hmm. and experiences.
Mm-hmm. So many.
So this book just gives us kind of some guidelines, some tools that we can hopefully apply to all the varying types. So let's jump into chapter 8 a little bit. Now, again, I have underlined right here on that very first page of chapter 8, one final word of caution. Before we start, you should only begin these sorts of conversations after you've spent considerable time fasting and praying for your child and equipping yourself, and only after your child has expressed some openness or curiosity mm-hmm. towards returning to the church. So just repeating what I said earlier. So jumping into the conversation, though, what would you say, Leslie, were some of the big takeaways of chapter 8? What kind of really stood out to you?
Well, the first one is, how often do we really talk with our children about faith as they're growing up?
Mm.
You know, why do they leave is part of the first part of the book. You know, we've covered a lot of that information about what goes on. But if they're not developing that incredibly strong relationship with Jesus, mm-hmm. it's going to be hard for us to bring them back.
Yeah.
So, you know, talking about faith was easy for us because I'm a Catholic school teacher. You know, teaching about the faith in fifth grade brought up all kinds of questions for me.
Yeah.
And so I bring them up at the dinner table. That was one of the things my husband said, you will eat dinner with us unless, you know, you're off in the sports or dance or whatever.
Yeah.
As often as possible, because that's where those conversations take place.
Mm-hmm.
So I bring up a little point, and as they were growing and they went to Catholic school and they chose it because I gave them options. They said, no, I can't go to Mass at a public school. And I go, okay, Lord, you're still working with them. Yay. I was so happy for that. But we would bring up those conversations. So there's a lot of families out there where the conversations never happen. And so it's kind of hard to bring your child back when the conversations didn't start until late.
Sure. Yeah.
So I think that's a super important point. And then
so they talk about the actual dialogue. I mean, there is some foundational work that if you have started early, that's awesome. But even if you haven't, maybe there's someone listening that says, man, we regret that we just didn't talk about it much.
But it can still happen.
Yeah.
The problem is that we have a hard time just listening.
Sure. Oh, so listening so hard.
After a certain point, this is part of chapter 8, that listening.
Yeah.
And just, you know, whatever they're saying about the church that maybe you're hurting they say it,
yeah.
right? But you still need to listen. You need to understand yeah. their viewpoint
yeah.
And where they're coming up with this. So you have to ask the questions. Well, how did you come to this conclusion?
Yeah.
You know, find out where they are, where they're coming from. And I think that makes a big difference.
Why
in the
do you think it's so hard to listen?
Because I want to tell everybody what I know. It's always like, and especially if a parent is with a child, it's like the parent always knows everything. And you have to really humble yourself. You have to go right back into,
And there was a time where that was what you had to do. Like when you think about like when kids are like toddlers, like you really do have to tell them everything.
Right.
And so I can just imagine, I mean, it's hard for anybody to listen, but I've noticed it's especially hard for parents to listen.
Very much.
So
that's why if I was talking with my nephews, I'd be a lot better at it probably
yeah.
than I'm talking to my own children. So thank
it's
God they're still
to,
on the right path. I'm really excited
to like truly listen to like what they really are saying and to let them like see that you're listening. I mean,
and that you don't make commentary or judgments or you know things that would cause them to roll their eyes and go, well, this is going nowhere, I'm just leaving, because sometimes that would happen. Your body language is
it
so
takes patience
important.
To listen.
Yeah,
it takes. Oh, and body language, you mentioned
very important. Very important.
I think they mentioned in here
they
a little bit
did.
About body language and how that's like the majority, maybe 50%
of the
remember.
Conversation. 55% of the conversation is body language.
Oh gosh, which yeah. oh my goodness, so. It's true though. It's so true. A lot of times you leave a conversation and you don't really remember exactly what was said, but you remember how you felt
very
as
much.
It was being said.
Right.
And the body language can certainly convey how you're feeling and all that. So.
And in the beginning of the conversation, you're not trying to win.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you're just trying to understand. Where are they coming
yeah.
from? Where did they get this information? How can you, you know, move them in the right direction without making them feel like you're a know-it-all
yeah.
kind of thing? So it's
yeah.
a kind of a touchy thing at first.
But it's powerful. It's so persuasive. And this is not just for this book, but any time that... that you desire to persuade somebody,
mm-hmm.
The power of listening to them and having a real connection of trust, I've noticed, seems to be a lot more effective. Even though it takes a little while longer, it seems to be a lot more effective than the resistance strategy. As you push one way, the other way just obviously like just pushes back, and then. And so listening is just so incredibly important, although very difficult.
The older I get, the more I understand how important that is. And I think that's another reason why grandparents are so important.
Yeah.
Because they do
yeah.
tend to listen a little bit more.
Oh.
Don't you think?
I think you're onto something.
Yeah. So
there's something
anyway,
about grandparents, because grandparents don't...
They have the patience and...
They also don't put the pressure on themselves to raise the kids.
Mm.
And so the kids don't feel that pressure.
Yeah.
And so there's just a little bit more of a trust.
So that sometimes an outside person may be a good person to start those conversations.
Yeah.
To
yeah.
bring someone back.
And sometimes maybe you're that outside person.
Yeah.
Maybe
to
you're
somebody
that,
else. This
to someone
is
else's
true.
Child.
This is true. Yeah.
Yeah.
And they mentioned that too in the book, and I'm going, yeah, that makes so much sense to
mm-hmm.
make that
it takes a village.
Yeah, for sure.
It takes a village. Let's jump into the five questions. Did you take a little note on, so on page 98.
What do you believe about this?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Why do you think that's true?
It's a section that says the five most powerful questions that you can ask.
Yes.
So in our effort to listen, people may say, well, I don't know how to listen. Or maybe some people think they're good at listening, but they're not too sure what to do next. The best way to listen is to ask questions. And a good, well-timed, and well-placed, well-worded question can be very powerful. So they gave us five examples. Did you take note of any
yeah.
of those?
Yeah, so like the first question is, what do you believe about this? Like, what do you believe about purgatory? What do you believe about any part of the Catholic Church? And then they would have to respond
yeah.
in some way, and you could say, well, why do you think that's
yeah.
true? What causes you to have that particular
yeah.
opinion?
And so you ask them, first of all, you challenge them to actually articulate what they believe, but to ask them, why do you think it's true, is a non-threatening way to get them to think critically. A lot of people sometimes don't actually develop their thoughts. They kind of just take an opinion or a side, and they don't give it much thought. No. And so to ask them, well, why do you think that is the true way? For some people, that might be the very first time they even consider that.
A lot of people will take what anyone has told them and then bring that to truth within themselves.
Yeah.
When they've never done any research or looked into it in any other viewpoint or other opinions. And that happens fairly regularly with young people.
Yeah.
They'll listen to their friends. They'll listen to the people on campus and college. They'll listen to their professors, unfortunately, who might bring up things that are not exactly what you would call cohesive with our faith or any faith in reality.
And if they do give a reason, then it at least gives us an opportunity to truly understand what perspective they're coming from.
Yes.
Because we might have had our own assumptions, and we might learn something. Perhaps it's something completely different.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
So those are two questions. Let's see what else.
Well, the third one is the same, similar. How did you come to believe that? Like, where did that come from?
Yeah.
And then the fourth one, what do you mean by this? So it's really important, I think, with a conversation to make sure you are understanding what they are saying.
Yeah.
They've said that twice.
Yeah.
In different chapters. Clarify the point. Is this really what you're saying? And then state what you think you heard.
Yeah.
And then they can say, no, that's not what I mean at all. Or, no, oh, that's kind of it.
Yeah. So, like, I'm trying to think of an example because kind of in the earlier chapters we talked about God and who God is. Mm-hmm. For example, let's define our terms to say, well, what do you mean by God?
Right.
And what I mean by God is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the Trinitarian God who revealed himself particularly through Jesus Christ. That's what I mean by God. They might mean the Santa Claus, pie in the sky kind of figure, and it's helpful for us to define our terms. Mm-hmm. Because what we might learn is that we're talking about two separate things, but using the same word for it.
Right.
So it's very important that we always define our terms. If there's ever something we disagree on, we hone in on the actual term itself and just make sure that we're actually talking about the same understanding of or the same definition of those words.
Yeah, identify what our definition is in the Catholic perspective compared to what maybe their definition is.
I mean, even a word like love, what does love mean? Well, we might have two completely definitions of love.
Yeah.
Maybe marriage. We might have a completely different definition of what marriage is. You know, we can keep going on and on, but...
Yeah.
So defining your terms is important. And then number five, let's see, what is number five?
What would you say to someone who says this?
Oh, yeah. So another non-threatening way, just to, asking them to respond to your objections, this is a way that you can provide the objection, the way in which you disagree with your child, but in a third person. So that they're not disagreeing with you, they're disagreeing with an imaginary figure, and they're just focusing on the topic. So if your son says, I don't believe in God, or I don't believe I have to go to confession to a priest.
There you go.
Then you can say, well, what would you say to someone who says that when they go to a confession with a priest, it makes them feel better. Instead of saying the objection from my point of view and making them refute me, you just put up a hypothetical person. What would you say to someone else who disagrees with that?
So instead of saying, whenever I go to confession, it just fills me with that sense of peace.
Yeah.
You would put it out there to say, what would you say to someone who says that confession really gives them
peace.
That sense of peace.
Yeah, how would you respond to that
person? So that
person?
You're not in the picture and it's non-threatening.
It's non-threatening and there's no conflict of interest. Now, we can stay on topic and we don't have to, confuse the topic with them just getting angry at mom or dad. Right. So,
and I found one more question in there that I thought was really important after those big five with the conversation. It says, what is the biggest thing that is keeping you away from the church?
Oh, yeah.
So when you come up with that, that largest roadblock, and sometimes it's more than one thing, but typically it's like one major thing, then that's something that you can work on and say, you know, let's talk about this and why it's such an impediment to your, you know, your returning or your wanting to return to the faith. So that was a good one too. And, you know, there's going to be a lot of times where you're going to have to sit there and absorb the criticisms. You're going to have to just kind of not be offended. You don't want to interrupt them when they're explaining themselves. And that's part
again,
of the hard,
why do you think that's so hard?
Because I want to shout to the world how wonderful my faith is, but they're not at that point. You know?
And sometimes
they're not
ready. Sometimes when they criticize, it's not even merited. You know, sometimes the criticism is not...
They're repeating what they've heard.
Even a good
else.
Criticism. Mm-hmm. But there's something powerful about the humility of just absorbing it and being patient with their anger and frustration. It really builds that trust and shows them that you genuinely care about. Right. So I really love that. So chapter 8 really jumped in a lot to the listening. Yeah. Chapter 9 kind of jumped into some further things that we can do to move the dialogue forward. Mm-hmm. So what were some of your big takeaways from this chapter?
There was a quote that was written in there.
It says,
if anyone in the discussion gets angry, you lose.
Oh, I love that.
The discussion is just not going to proceed forward. So anger will do nothing to help your situation and to help your child or your friend or your family member who you're trying to work with. So keep the discussion moving in a positive direction. You have to stay humble. You don't know it all. You know, by the grace of God, you know, some of the words will come. The Holy Spirit, you got to call on the Holy Spirit pretty often, I think, in these conversations to give you the right words to say.
Yeah, you bring a good point. Sometimes when emotions get high, it becomes a barrier. It becomes hard for us to really think clearly. And it's okay, he says, to say, you know what? This is no longer helpful or productive, so why don't we take a pause?
Right, and it's okay to do that.
It's okay to do that.
It's not something that's going to come about in a day or two or even 2 weeks. It could be a couple of years, these little conversations here and there. It could be. You're hoping it's a little less time than that. But, you know, you have to see the situation for what it is and just work with it and what you have.
So we have to be emotionally aware. Mm-hmm. And when emotions get high, take a pause, restore the relationship, and pick it back up another time. Love that. What else
stood
out?
We talked about the body language already.
Yeah.
A lot of times we can see their viewpoint. We can see their side of things. So it's good for them to understand you get it in a certain sense. But then to bring it back to why the Catholic Church believes in what they believe in and kind of move in that direction. I think that's a different chapter, though. But clear up those misconceptions the best that you can without making them feel like you're preaching to them.
Right.
So,
which only comes from listening. We have to know what their misconceptions are.
Right.
I love the quote from Archbishop Fulton Sheen. Did you happen to notice that one in there?
Probably. Go ahead.
He says, and he's kind of famously quoted for this. Let's see if I can find it. He says, there are not over 100 people in the United States who hate the Catholic Church. But there are millions, however, who hate what they wrongly believe to be the Catholic Church.
Correct. That
which is, of course, quite a different thing. Which goes back to defining the terms.
Correct.
A lot of people have misconceptions. And what they think the Catholic Church is and stands for, I wouldn't like either. But sometimes whenever you discover the truth of what really is going on, that often resolves a lot of issues.
And a lot of times we don't know the answer. So we're having a conversation and they come up with a comment and you're going, I'm not sure how to respond to that. I know what I feel in my heart is true, but I really want to give you the right answer. So it's okay to say, let me get back with you on that.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay to do that. And that way you're learning more and you're understanding more how to respond to their misconception.
Yeah.
So that you can both have the right understanding of what that is. So
exactly. Yeah, we gotta get on the same page.
Right.
Did you take a little note of the shoe pebble?
I sure did.
Questions?
I thought that was really interesting. So, planting those little seeds are great opportunities. And sometimes you throw out a question and they can't get the question out of their head.
Yeah.
So they're... that pebble is like a pebble in your shoe. It's kind of bothering you all the time.
Yeah.
And when it's bothering you, you tend to want to do something about it.
Yeah.
So then they may actually take it upon themselves to look up something.
So a shoe pebble question would be not a question that you desire to be answered right away.
Mm-hmm.
But we call it a shoe pebble, the bothering question, because we want it to be a question that they don't forget about. And through the weeks on their own time, it keeps coming up in their head.
Right, right.
So did you get an example of maybe some of the shoe questions?
So if you happen to be someone who's decided God does not exist, you're an atheist, okay? So you think, what do you think the strongest argument for God is? So normally they're saying all these different comments about why God isn't.
Yeah.
But
we're asking them to take the other side.
Yes.
Give me what the strongest reason for it is.
Right.
And then what's wrong with it?
Correct. And then another question might be for someone else.
Leo saying hi. Hey,
yes,
Leo.
He is.
I know he's kind of.
To be with
this
us.
Is about we've had enough time of ignoring him, and now he's.
and he's good.
He's wondering why we haven't given him any attention.
So another question for Shoe Pebble might be: What do you think is the best reason to be Catholic?
Mm.
And why don't you agree with it?
So what we're challenging them to do there is we're challenging them to refute the strongest argument.
Mm-hmm.
So we're challenging them first to identify the strongest argument.
Right.
And then to refute it so that they can at least be well thought out about why they disagree.
For sure.
These are that I love. I think it's brilliant to
I think that the biggest thing though when you're reacting to someone is to make sure you're speaking with them with that joy of your faith in your heart and that positivity.
Yeah.
So when you're kind of down about the faith and you're kind of looking at them with these body languages again, that you shouldn't be frowning about it. You should just make sure you're listening, leaning forward as part of body language as well, being interested in what they have to say. But to make sure they understand how much joy you have in your own faith, because they're going to want some of that.
It's contagious.
I think so, and I've seen that in other people, and a lot of people in this church too. That's one of the things that drew us here, is when you start to talk about people and be with them in community, which is another chapter. Community is so incredibly important. You see that joy, and you want to be part of that.
Yeah,
you want to be part of that. So
well, good.
That's kind of important.
I agree. There's something contagious about joy, especially real joy, authentic joy.
Mm-hmm.
Because joy, he even brings up, there's so little of it in the world. With all the, there's so much negativity and drama and or promiscuity or whatever. They're just, whenever you encounter real joy in the world, it's powerful.
There.
It's powerful.
There.
Let me check my battery.
Alrighty.
For those who are watching, just to make sure the battery is still good. All right. And, hey, Leo, I'm going to ask you to sit, buddy. Good boy. All right. And we still have two more chapters to talk about before we go and play. So let's spend some time on chapter 10. So, now we're getting back to what you brought up earlier, the power of the invite.
Right.
So maybe just say a few more words about why you think the invitation is so important.
Well, as my roommate did for me.
Yeah.
Early on in my conversion story, that invite is so incredibly important, and it's you need to follow up with it though.
Yeah.
It's not just a one and done thing.
Yeah.
You need to make sure you're following up with that.
And not be discouraged.
One of the things that's easiest, I think, is to bring somebody into the church while the church is doing some function, a festival, a bingo night, anything that will bring them into the essence of the church without the mass first, if that's, you know, still not something that they're ready to do, and meet the people and bring that joy back into their life and say, okay, this feels right. This feels good. You know, there's an awful lot of different Catholic churches out there, though. So you have to find the right one that fits that personality. And again, if you're away from that person, then it's kind of hard for you to, you know,
it is a little bit difficult.
But you can research. I mean, you can look things up. You can call. There's so many different programs. Like my son has a program for the young adult group in Kansas City, called City on a Hill, where all the young adults from like 18 to 35, most are single, some are not. There's a lot, 800 maybe, and then at any particular time, 200 of them might meet for this. He has adoration time for them, confession readily available, all kinds of different things. So when you can find a young adult group, or a teen group, to get them motivated. Mission trips, huge.
Oh, huge. Mission trips,
That's where my son was converted. I think it was his very first one between freshman and sophomore year, and he said, he came home, he said, Mom, when are we going on vacation next year? I go, well, I don't even know where we're going next year. Well, we have to work it around the mission.
Love that.
So it's like, whoo, and this was evangelical group. It was not a Catholic mission, so it had a huge different group of people, and he was open to everything, and he just swallowed up the word of God and helping people and loving it. So you never know where their connection is going to come, but a lot of times it's not, it's outside the mass, and that's the whole idea, is the mass is the last, you know.
The mass is the pinnacle.
It's the pinnacle.
And
it
so
is.
for many people, it can be overwhelming or intimidating. And there's so many other places, is what I'm hearing you
very
say.
Very much.
You can invite them to.
So.
But not just invite, like go with them and connect them to other people. Or if it's a situation where you can't go with them, at least have someone else there ready to welcome them and connect them. So it's just a powerful testament to the relationship just comes first. I mean, to connect people, human relationships. Is very powerful.
I love that chapter because there's so many things in there that I related to my life, the retreat I went on. And then I talked to my husband. He said he went on a Curcio, and it says changed his life. And the Axe retreats are really popular here, I guess, in Lafayette. I haven't been on one of those yet, but my father-in-law has.
Oh, wow.
So last year he went.
Cool.
So it's one of those things where you never finish learning about your faith.
There's always growth.
So this is
so the power of the invite. Don't underestimate, and if they say no, keep inviting later. I mean, don't nag. There's a difference. But to not give up on the continuing to invite. So chapter 11 is closing the loop. Now this one was challenging, I have to be honest.
I think so too.
This one was I think the most difficult chapter for me to take in. It does present a good challenge, but I think a beautiful one. So what are some of your takeaways?
Closing the loop basically means once they've made that decision to return to the church, don't let them go.
Yeah.
Don't just let them go on their own. You got to follow up. You've got to make sure that there's that connection stays.
Yeah.
And that's the closing of the loop kind of thing. So.
It's like you got to close the deal.
Maybe they're not completely ready, but you kind of push them a little sometimes.
Yeah.
You say, why don't we just go ahead and just move forward right here, or say a prayer with me so that you can, you know, follow that call because I see it in you, I feel it in you, and I want it for you, and I think you want it for yourself.
Yeah.
So you have to continue to encourage without pushing.
Yeah.
You know, to make sure that they close that loop and that they do get connected and stay connected.
The idea here is this is whenever they do decide that they're ready to come back.
Yeah.
But at that point, although we're excited and we want to rejoice, what we have to do is make a call to action. Make some kind of concrete action that makes that desire to come back actually real. Mm-hmm. So they give a few examples, like you mentioned. One of the examples they say is connect them to a priest, so that the priest can then discern what are their next steps. Maybe closing the loop is getting a certain sacrament. Maybe they got to get their confirmation because they never got it.
Mm-hmm. Or making a good confession.
Probably, most likely, that's going to be a big piece. Go get your go make confession. Or maybe the call to action is, let's say a prayer right now, together, out loud. And that was the part that was challenging, because it almost feels, like he said, it feels Protestant, but that's not exclusively Protestant. This is very Catholic at its essence. It's, let's say a prayer right now, vocally, just inviting Jesus to be the most important part of my life.
And when I read that, I thought Protestant immediately, you know, because that's it. Accept Jesus into your life. Be, you know, reborn into the faith. Well, we don't need to be reborn. We're baptized Catholic,
but,
and we're always in the faith.
But we can make that concrete choice.
Definitely.
All the time.
Yes.
And that's something that our Protestant brothers and sisters have figured out good. And so it almost feels like it's theirs, but that can be shared. That is totally at the heart of Christianity, to choose Jesus and to make a concrete action for that. Let's do that now. Lord, I choose you.
We don't say that out loud.
Maybe it's good to just like help your child when he's ready to just make that commitment verbally. And that can really, just that concrete action can really be a moment of closure. It's mm-hmm. it's a moment of commitment. And we need to draw them to just, not just to be interested in Jesus, but to commit to Jesus.
Because without that personal plan with Jesus in your heart, you can't really move forward. Because it really won't make a lot of sense for you.
Right.
It's like a lot of people will go to Mass, but they don't have that connection with Jesus. It's just they go to Mass.
Yeah.
So making that connection is super important for them to stay, I think.
So I got a lot from these chapters. I was excited that these chapters were a lot more concrete.
I enjoyed reading them a lot.
It definitely gives us a little more concrete skills to kind of take in, or concrete tools to kind of take into the conversation. So, Leslie, what would you say just to kind of wrap up our conversation? Anyone out there that just feels maybe a little overwhelmed with all of these tools, maybe just still feels a little discouraged by these things. Maybe they don't see how it's going to work. They think that these tools are good, but maybe it's not going to be, but it may not work for their child. Is there any words of encouragement you want to add to anybody watching out there?
Starting the conversation is where it's going to happen. It truly is. But if you never start the conversation, it will never happen. So even if you have all these tools behind you, but you don't use them, then it's all for naught. So the idea here is it's going to hurt a little. In some cases, you're going to find some people are so far away, or they've talked themselves into things that are so not friendly with the Catholic Church, that it's going to hurt a little. You're going to have to be humble. You're going to have to accept the criticisms and be willing to do that for the sake of their soul and for the sake of your family and, you know, being able to bring that connection back in. It would be all worth it. I'm ready to try it, but I haven't quite gotten through that second step of learning more.
Sure.
I have some good background, but my goodness, I need to equip myself with a whole lot more.
Sure. And we want to do that together as a parish. We want to equip each other so that we can get those conversations started and just have the courage.
Very much.
It doesn't have to all happen all overnight.
It usually does not.
But Brandon does a good job of reminding us that no child is without hope, that that everyone has hope, that the Lord desires for your child to come back to the faith even more than you do. And I love that he's offered us a real path moving forward. So.
And I think there's a lot of roadblocks in some cases, which is going to come up in the next conversation.
Yeah. Yeah.
If I understand correctly.
It will,
It comes up at the end of chapter 11, and I'm thinking, those are some pretty good roadblocks. And then he explains a lot about how to take care of those.
So you're giving us a teaser. So for next week, we're going to be jumping into some of the major roadblocks and major objections that your child may have in these conversations.
Yes,
so stay tuned. But Leslie, it's been a pleasure.
Oh, thank you for inviting me, Father.
Yes.
It's been a lot of fun, and I'm really enjoying learning so much about what I can do to help those that need a little bit more encouragement.
Absolutely.
To come on back to the faith.
Yeah, we're in this together.
Yeah,
so
for sure.
Thank everyone. Join us again next Tuesday at 8 p.m. for episode 4.
Great. Thanks very much.